church, we have more guys. Sing along. Some of you know this song, but you don't have to. But you can sing with me. You're always welcome.
Satisfied as long as I was. Good morning. And welcome to Redeemer. It finally feels like fall out there, doesn't it? Beautiful day. I got to dust off my jacket for the first time in months, put it on. My favorite time of the year, fall. I love how the church, you know, you can see it Sunday by Sunday as the light from the Jesus stained glass window makes its way across. God is good. Thank you for joining me today in worship. Today is week number 2 of our Micah 6 verse 8 series. As we try and be more like God, we try to be more like Christ. And that includes being kind and humble and patient. As we get closer and closer to Election Day here in the United States, I know it can bring out some tension, some anxiety, some anger. And so it's just good to remind ourselves that we are to be like God, humble. And today we're going to focus on being kind. What a great concept, a great Christian concept, to be kind to one another, even if we don't always agree with each other. There's several things in your bulletin to raise up. 1 week from Wednesday, so about 10 days from today, our annual trunk or treat here at Redeemer. This is just a really neat community event. We've got all kinds of kids that come to our parking lot. Just a great night here at Redeemer. So please do help get word out in our community. We're going to do this October 23rd from 5:30 to 6:30. October 23rd. So get the word out. Also, if you want to help participate, we'd always love to have more people decorate a trunk or a car or a truck with some type of theme. And there's hundreds of different ideas out there. Just simply Google it and find a good kind of theme to decorate your vehicle and then hand candy out that night. So we're always looking for more people to participate. If you think you might be able to do this, please do. We're just always, the more people we have, the more spots we have, the better the night is. Do contact our church office, though, if you're planning on doing so. Also, today is the last Sunday to sign up for our fall box lunches. Our youth ministry has been doing this for several years now. These are Subway sandwiches that are better than Quiznos, better than Jimmy John's, better than Subway, because the proceeds go to Redeemer and Redeemer Kids. But honestly, they are great sandwiches, and there's a pickle and a cookie. They're $8 per, and again, all the proceeds help go support our teens here at Redeemer. There's information in your bulletin. Just tear off that page and make sure to hand that in today, because next Sunday those will be available for you to take home following worship next Sunday. Lastly, this summer we did something kind of fun called Good News from the Pews. And I know it's not summer anymore, but still love to get them. And I did receive one this morning from Brenda Von Sagren, bragging on her son Holden a little bit. So happy to pass this along. On Friday, October 11th, Holden Von Sagren had the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering Scholarship Award Banquet. Holden was awarded as a scholarship. And so we celebrate with Holden and his education at UNO. He's doing great work there. So something to honor and celebrate as we just rejoice with Holden this morning. Would you please rise if you're able as we sing our opening hymn, Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Salvation that all who
be seated. Almighty God, from whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let us pray. Gracious God, we come before you today, seeking hearts filled with kindness. Teach us to see others through your eyes, with compassion and love. Help us to speak words that heal and to act in ways that lift and encourage. When we encounter difficult moments, give us patience and understanding. May your Spirit guide us to be kind in all we do, reflecting your grace to everyone we meet. Let our kindness bring light to the world. Amen.
Our theme for this series is taken from Micah, the 6th chapter. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our first lesson is taken from Proverbs, the 11th chapter. A kind-hearted woman gains honor, but ruthless men gain only wealth. Those who are kind benefit themselves, but the cruel bring ruin on themselves. A wicked person earns deceptive wages, but the one who sows righteousness reaps a sure reward. Truly the righteous attain life, but whoever pursues evil finds death. The Lord detests those whose hearts are perverse, but he delights in those whose ways are blameless. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson is taken from Ephesians, the 4th chapter. Each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are angry, and do not let give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Ella. This time I'll ask the boys and girls that are in church to collect our penny offerings. And as you do, come on up for the children's message. Come up, kiddos. Thank you. kiddos. How are you today? Isn't it kind of cool how the sun comes through that stained glass? Kimmy, it looks like pretty bright, isn't it? But I just love how it comes this time of the day, this time of the year. It's kind of like God's love and God's light is shining down on us as we gather today to worship Him. I want you to raise your hand if you like sports. Who likes sports here? I like sports too. And I think that this is probably my favorite time of the year for sports, because two of my favorite sports are going on right now. The first is baseball, and I love baseball. Baseball is my favorite sport, and right now there's the playoffs. Now, if you've ever seen a person hit a home run in baseball, a big home run, what does the crowd do? Ah, I can't believe it! Home run! And as the person's running around the bases, everybody's going crazy, they're all clapping from, woo! So baseball, yeah! And the other sport, there's actually two other sports going on, right? Volleyball. Raise your hand if you love volleyball. So the Huskers had a big game on Friday night, right? And won a very close game against Purdue. And volleyball, when there's a Husker, gets a spike or an ace when they serve it, what do the Husker fans do? Yeah! Or like something that one of the cheers is, roof, 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 right? So they get a big block. Or football, if someone has a big touchdown, a long pass, and you catch it, and you score it, what does the crowd do then? And in football, sometimes the person that scores a touchdown does a celebration dance. Have you ever seen this? Have you ever seen a person do a celebration dance? In fact, a few years ago, there was a really good football player named Justin Jefferson. Raise your hand if you've ever heard of Justin Jefferson. Yeah, he's a wide receiver who plays for the Minnesota Vikings, and they're 5-0, and he's having a great season. Maybe the best receiver in the NFL right now. Do you know what Justin Jefferson, his touchdown dance looks like? Can you do it for me? Can you do it, the gritty? Yeah, let's see if Cooper can do the gritty. Let's see the gritty. Awesome! That's it, that's the gritty. Cooper, you saved your pastor some embarrassment because I was gonna try to do it myself, but I'm glad you stepped up and did it. Yeah, you're right. And I know a lot of kids, they all learn how to do that gritty, right? And the whole point of it is when an athlete does something good, sometimes we say that athlete should get the glory. That athlete should get the praise and the glory because they did something really, really cool. But it also gets me to think about, yes, athletes should get glory, and they should get, you know, praise for being good at what they do. But do you know who ultimately should get more glory than any human being on earth? Just holler it out if you know it. God, yeah, you're right. In fact, here's what the Bible says about giving God glory. Listen to it. It's from Psalm 19, verse 1. It says, the heavens, so the whole universe, the heavens declare the glory of God. The entire universe. Ah, God, you're awesome. And the sky above proclaims his handiwork. I'm going to ask you a question. Who created the entire universe? If you know it, just holler it. Don't you think that deserves glory? And yeah, you're awesome, God. Who gives us life? If you know it, just holler it out. And don't you think that deserves, you're awesome, God. Who causes, you know, the seasons to change? We're going into fall. Who causes that? God, yeah. And so, you know, I watch sports, and I love sports, and I love when my team does well. It's fun to cheer. It's fun to get excited. But even more than that, we should get excited for God. We should give God the glory that he deserves. All right? Now, you guys are going to help me because you're kids. And so you guys can have more fun in church than sometimes adults can do it, okay? So we're going to get loud. We're going to give God glory, all right? And so we're going to stand up, all right? And on the count of three, we're going to cheer for God, all right? And, you know, we've done something like this before. So I'm going to say it's not going to be like, yeah, God, way to go. We love you. Not going to be like that, right? We're going to get really excited. We're going to let God hear us. He's sending his light down on us right now. So if you're in the church, pretend you're a kid, all right? Don't be too cool to give God glory because he deserves our praise and our glory. Okay, on the count of three, we're going to give God glory, okay? One, two, three. Yay! Woo! Way to go, God! All right, we're Nebraska Lutherans. I think that's about as good as we can do. That was good. All right, kiddos, take a seat. We're going to say a prayer. Thank you for being in church. Parents, grandparents, thank you for bringing your kids to God's house as we continue to learn about God and Jesus. Let's pray. Okay, let's talk to God. Everybody say, dear God, thank you, thank you, thank you for sports and fun and being able to run around. But help us give you glory, for you deserve it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, stay right there for a second because Pastor's got our candy bar for the day. And believe it or not, I brought my favorite candy bar. It's kind of a candy bar that isn't typically people's favorites. You know, the typical ones probably Snickers or Twix or Reese's. My favorite is the Heath bar. Raise your hand if you've ever had a Heath bar before. They're really, really good. I think you'll like them, all right? So take it and let me know what you think of it. But come grab your candy, and thank you for being in church this Sunday morning.
I'll take a Heath bar over any of those others.
You're welcome.
Oh, man, those are the bombs.
You're very welcome.
I should this time.
Oh, yeah.
You're very welcome.
Thank you.
rise, if you're able, for the reading of our Holy Gospel. According to St. Luke, the 10th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. An expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law? Jesus replied. How do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please remain standing as we sing in Jesus' name.
I speak the name of Jesus over you. In your hurting, in your sorrow, I will ask my God to move. I speak the name 'cause it's all
Please be seated. I like to start my messages off with something a little bit lighthearted. And I heard about this elderly pastor who's having all kinds of teeth issues. Went to his dentist, and the dentist gave him the bad news. We've got to pull out your teeth and put dentures in. The elderly pastor didn't want to hear this, but it was what it was. And so he went and did it. Had new dentures placed. And the next Sunday, 2 days later, got into the pulpit and only preached for about 3 minutes that first Sunday. And then people thought, well, that's pretty short. The next Sunday, got in the same pulpit and preached for about 15 minutes. The third Sunday, same pastor gets into the pulpit and preaches and preaches and talks and talks and talks for an hour and a half. That preacher just kept going on and on and on. And his people, his congregation, asking the pastor, what's going on? And the elderly pastor explained, well, that the first Sunday, my gums were just so sore, I couldn't stand the pain, and I had to stop after a couple minutes. The second Sunday, that the dentures were fitting in a little bit nicer, and I felt more like myself and was able to kind of just preach my normal message. The third Sunday, I accidentally put my wife's dentures in. And just couldn't stop talking and speaking and speaking and speaking. That's a new one, all right? So let me know if that one should stay in the rotation or not. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and from our Lord and from our Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. Today's week number 2 of our sermon series on Micah 6:8. Sometimes I think in faith it's best to keep things simple. You know, sometimes we have this tendency to overcomplicate things. I'm reminded of Jesus' message to people in his day and age to have faith like a child. You know, sometimes we can just get so deep into thinking about all these different complicated things about what we're meant to do, what does God want from our lives? Sometimes it's good to just focus on one verse. So that's really what we're doing these 3 weeks. Micah 6, verse 8. Do justice. Be the type of person that seeks justice for all human beings. Doesn't matter who we are, doesn't matter where we live, our skin color, if we're a man or a woman. This is a Christian thing. This is something that God demands of us, that we treat each other the same regardless of who we are, and we strive to make sure that other people have justice in their lives as well. It's an American thing, the Pledge of Allegiance. You know, you get up and you say the Pledge of Allegiance, and we pray that justice for all people is something we strive to do as Americans. Today we're going to talk about kindness. And we are about 3 weeks away from Election Day. And so I think being reminded that we are to be like God, and the aspect of being kind, being gracious, not allowing anger and frustration and all the other things that probably will be coming into so many Americans' lives the next 3 weeks. It's good to hear this from Micah 6, verse 8, to love kindness. That's going to be our theme for the day. Now, we talked a little bit about this last Sunday, but Micah 6, 8 comes from the Old Testament book of Micah, and Micah is a prophet. He's known as a minor prophet. I know that makes him sound like he's lesser than, but major prophets and minor prophets are not, you know, differentiated based on their importance. They're just called minor prophets because the books are smaller. Did you know that? So a minor prophet's called a minor prophet because the length of them, it's shorter. And so Micah is a shorter book. He's one of the minor prophets, meaning God speaks through him. God has a message for his people, and he's speaking through Micah. And Micah lived around the year 700 BC. So about 2,700 years ago, a long time ago. And the people during 700 BC were under a massive threat. The Assyrians, this huge empire, no longer exists. The Assyrians kind of live in more modern-day Iraq and then farther north of Israel, and they were about to attack. God's people saw it. The Assyrians were going to come in, they were going to attack, and they were afraid. And they wanted to know, God, what do we have to do here and now to protect ourselves? They saw the Assyrians coming, and they were afraid. And so they go to God. In Micah 6, verse 7, if you want to open your bulletin, I love it. Micah 6, 7, you hear the people start to, you know, beg God, what do we have to do to prevent this nation coming in and crushing us? What do you want from us? So Micah 6, verse 7, this is page 3 of your bulletin, it asks, will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams? You know, if we line up all these rams and we bring them before you, God, as sacrifices, will that make you happy? Or will you be pleased with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? These big sacrifices. But I don't stop at that. Read the next line there. Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Now, what's it asking there? It's asking, you know, if I offer my child, my son or daughter as a sacrifice to you, God, will this somehow make you happy with us? And God's looking down. He's like, what are you talking about? What have I been teaching you? I taught you through the Ten Commandments. I taught you through my law. Everything that I've taught you, the years that I've been, you're a God and you've forgotten it all. No, I won't be happy if you sacrifice your child. Where do you get that from? And then God has this to say, and I love this. Micah 6, 8, our theme verse for our series. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? Not sacrifices, not, you know, not rams or olive oil, not human sacrifices, but requires this, to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Simple. Do that. That is what God wants from us. Now, this idea of kindness, it's up here on the screen. This is the Hebrew for kindness. And, you know, I do this just every once in a while to prove that I went to seminary, right? That I can look at Hebrew. I'm kidding. But this is the Hebrew word for kindness. And if it looks like Hebrew, it is Hebrew. And we're not meant to be able to read it, but this word is hesed. Everybody say that? Hesed. You said a little bit of Hebrew this morning. Hesed, and it's interesting. Again, Hebrew you read right to left, and actually the vowels are always located underneath the letters. In Hebrew, you put the vowels underneath the letters, and this is a very important word because hesed is a quality of God. Hesed, kindness, compassion is not something that we human beings should do just because God wants it from us, but this is an actual quality of God. We read about this in Exodus, the 34th chapter, and all of this happens after Moses gets the Ten Commandments. Moses speaks to God through the burning bush. God delivers the people from slavery out of Egypt. He's leading them to the promised land. And do you remember what the people do when Moses is on top of Mount Sinai receiving the Ten Commandments? What are the people doing? They're betraying God. They're setting up this golden calf to be their new God. And you would think God would be downright irked by this, angry by this, ready to just, you know, get rid of these people. And there's a sense of anger from God, certainly in Exodus, but also this, hesed, a quality of God, comes through in this moment. So Exodus 34, beginning in verse 5, the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with Moses and proclaimed his name, being the Lord. And God passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God. He is slow to anger, abounding in hesed. There's that word again, hesed, being mercy, being kindness, being love and faithfulness, maintaining, again, hesed, this idea of mercy, kindness, maintaining it to thousands and thousands and thousands. So when you read this in Micah 6:8, to love hesed, to love kindness, we're not just supposed to do it because God tells us to do it. We're to do it because we are to strive to be like God. God's word tells us to be like God. Now, we're going to fall short of that. We're human beings, but part of our Christian walk is hopefully each and every day we walk more closely in Jesus' footsteps. We strive to be righteous, following the way of God, following the way of Christ, following this idea of hesed, kindness, mercy, and grace. Now, this sermon series, I picked to go through it very intentionally because, you know, this is the time, every 4 years, it seems like the election season just brings out the worst in some of us. Not all of us. Some of us could care less about politics. Some of us, you know, just kind of want it to come and go. But for a lot of us, the next 3 weeks is just really going to bring up frustration and anger as we continue to see these political ads each and every day. You can't turn on the TV, a football game this afternoon, without seeing them time and time again. Billions of dollars spent on these political ads. Anybody want to guess how many billions of dollars are expected to be spent just this election season? How many billions? The expectation, the estimate is $10.7 billion. $10.7 billion just on this. It's everywhere. And all these political ads are just, they're so negative. And I find them kind of nasty a lot. And it's always, you know, why you should not vote for the opponent and how they're so evil. And it can bring out just this kind of anger, this kind of just an enragement and just frustration. And, you know, these next 3 weeks, Christians, people of Redeemer, we can't control what's going on in the rest of the world. We can't control what's going on, you know, at our aunt's house who lives in Kentucky, or our uncle who lives in New York, or wherever there might be. We can't control that, but we can't control what's going on inside of here and inside of here. And if you're the type of person that gets so wrapped up in politics and angry, remind yourself of this kindness, this hesed, this mercy. Practical advice, get off of Facebook for the next 3 weeks, all right? Just shut it down for 3 weeks. I promise you, it'll still be there after the election. It'll still be there. Turn off the TV if you need to just remove yourself from this anger. We are to be a kind-hearted people, this idea of kindness. I've got a very short video I'd like you to see on this idea of being kind. I really liked it.
It has been said that our lives are a reflection of our thoughts. If this is the case, shouldn't we be watching our thoughts with care? And how do those thoughts not only affect ourselves, but the people around us? There's a story of a young boy that walks into a cafe and sits down at a table. A waitress comes over and sets a glass of water down. The boy looks up at her and asks how much an ice cream sundae is. The waitress looks down and tells him it's a dollar. The boy then pulls his hand out of his pocket and looks at a number of coins in it. He again looks up at the waitress. How much is a bowl of just plain ice cream? The boy asks. The waitress now notices people waiting for the table and gets a little impatient. She looks down at the boy and tells him it's 75 cents. The boy then looks at his hand again and examines the coins. He looks back up to the waitress and he says, "I'll just take a plain bowl of ice cream then." The waitress then comes back with the ice cream and the bill and sets it next to him. The boy finishes his ice cream and takes his bill up to the cashier to pay it. As the waitress comes back over to wipe down the table, she swallows hard at what she saw. Neatly placed next to the ice cream, the boy had left a quarter for her tip. See, the way we look at the world shapes the people we become. These simple acts of kindness teach us lessons for change. We can all learn something from the boy in this story, like his incredible compassion for others and his true desire to work on the person he wants to become.
I love that video. Be kind. As we close our message this morning, I want to do a little bit of congregational participation. So hopefully you received an index card as well as a mini pencil. Raise your hand if you do not have one. Raise your hand if you are missing your index card or mini pencil. If you are missing, we'll have an usher come in and get it for you. What we're going to do with these, I think part of the problem we have a hard time sometimes practicing kindness is we get centered on ourselves. We've got our own problems. We've got our own issues, and we can get selfish that we aren't compassionate and kind to the people that are in our lives. I heard someone say, and I think this is true, everybody's got something going on in their lives right now that really the rest of the world knows nothing about. Some type of issue, some type of conflict, some type of turmoil that's going on in their lives here and now, but we're good at just putting on a smile, not airing it out, and we just kind of shoulder these problems on our own. Here's what we're going to do as we close out. On this note card, first, hear me say this. Do not put your name. These are meant to be anonymous. We're not meant to make this a gossip thing. We're not meant to air this whatsoever, so do not write your name on these, okay? I do want you to write down your own personal struggle right now. Because what we're going to do, we are all going to put these in these baskets, all right? Don't put your name on it, your own personal struggle. Put these in the baskets. And then on your way home this morning, you are going to grab one of these. That's not your own. And you're going to pray for this person. You don't know who it is. You don't know their whole life story. But you're going to pray for this person. You're going to think about this person. It's going to remind you that we're in this life together. We are to be kind. We are to be compassionate. We are to lift each other up. So we're going to spend about a minute writing these down. Julie's going to play some light music. Then we will close this morning's message with a prayer. But please do write these down. There's a basket here as well as in the back. So please just make sure that these get into the basket. But let's lift these thoughts and these struggles to our God. Please come forward and place in the basket. And let us pray. Heavenly Father, we pray for your presence to be with us today, the days and the weeks ahead. Help us to love kindness. Help us to practice mercy. Help us to be like Jesus, to forgive and to just love. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Generous God, as we bring our offerings before you today, we are reminded of the kindness you show us daily. Help us to give with hearts full of compassion, knowing that our gifts will be used to spread love and mercy to those in need. May these offerings reflect our desire to walk in kindness, following the example of Christ, and bless others as you have so richly blessed us. Amen. Let us confess the Christian faith that we hold in common using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Gracious and loving God, we lift up all those working in the fields and on the farms during this harvest season. We pray for the safety of farmers, grain elevator workers, and everyone in the agriculture community. Protect them from harm. Guide their hands, and strengthen their bodies as they work long hours. May they feel your presence in their labor, and may this harvest be abundant and blessed. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of wisdom and peace, as we approach this upcoming election season, we ask for your guidance in our words and actions. Help us to be kind, patient, and understanding with those whose views may differ from our own. May we seek unity over division, treating others with respect and compassion. Let our conversations reflect your love, and may we strive for peace and justice in all we do. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we come before you with deep gratitude for the firefighters and volunteer firefighters who selflessly serve our communities. We thank you for their courage, dedication, and willingness to risk their lives to protect others. Bless them with strength, wisdom, and safety as they respond to emergencies. May they feel appreciated and supported in their work, and may your protection surround them always. We give thanks for the service. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Faithful God, we thank you for the Christian community of Redeemer Church and the warmth it brings to all who enter. We ask that you continue to guide us in becoming a welcoming and loving place for all seeking a spiritual home. May we be a beacon of your grace, extending kindness, acceptance, and hope to those who are searching. Help us reflect your love in all we do, inviting others to experience your presence here. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate God, we lift up all those affected by Hurricane Milton in Florida this past week. We ask for your healing and comfort for those who are grieving, injured, or displaced. Strengthen the responders and volunteers offering aid and support. Guide communities as they rebuild and grant them the resilience they need. Surround them with your love and hope, and may your peace be present in the midst of this hardship. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Healing God, we come before you lifting up all those who are hurting in body, mind, or spirit. We ask for your comfort and peace to surround them in their struggles. Bring healing to those in pain, peace to those with troubled minds, and strength to those in despair. May they feel your presence in their journey toward wholeness. And may we be instruments of your love and care. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Would you please rise as we sing our sending hymn, Let the Whole Creation Cry.
Now earth awake and see.
Again, grab one of these note cards on your way home. Be praying for this person and remind yourselves to be kind to the people that we encounter in your life. Just grab one, read it, and then discard of it. You know, this is not something we want to publicize or anything like that. We're just praying for these people in our lives. Sunday school, right now, immediately after worship, junior high, high school youth, this side, younger kids will sing and then go on this side, grab a donut, grab a coffee. Thank you for being in worship, especially to our guests and our visitors today. You make Redeemer a better place to worship God. Adult Bible study, always open, always love having new people join us. We're going to be looking at Daniel this morning, but specifically Daniel 4 and Nebuchadnezzar and how God is God of all people. It does not matter if it's the Israelites or the Babylonians. So we'll be looking at Daniel 4 this morning. Grab your coffee and donuts and join us in this room over here. May the Lord bless you and keep you, filling your hearts with compassion and kindness. As you go, may your words and actions reflect the love of Christ, bringing light to those around you. May you walk in grace, showing kindness to others in all you do. And may the peace of God be with you always. Amen. Go in peace. Follow the way who is Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God.